15. He didn't like that. His lower lip went in under his teeth, and his eyebrows drew down sharply at the corners. His whole face became sharp and foxy and mean. The buzzer kept up its song. I didn't like it either. If the visitors should happen to be Eddie Mars and his boys, I might get chilled off just for being there. If it was the police, I was caught with nothing to give them but a smile and a promise. And if it was some of Brody's friends, supposing he had any, they might turn out to be tougher than he was. The blonde didn't like it. She stood up in a surge and chipped at the air with one hand. Nerve tension made her face old and ugly. Watching me, Brody jerked a small drawer in the desk and picked a bone-handled automatic out of it. He held it at the blonde. She slid over to him and took it, shaking. "Sit down next to him," Brody snapped. "Hold it on him low down, away from the door. If he gets funny, use your own judgment. We ain't licked yet, baby." "Oh, Joe," the blonde wailed. She came over and sat next to me on the davenport and pointed the gun at my leg artery. I didn't like the jerky look in her eyes. The door buzzer stopped humming, and a quick, impatient rapping on the wood followed it. Brody put his hand in his pocket on his gun and walked over to the door and opened it with his left hand. Carmen Sternwood pushed him back into the room by putting a little revolver against his lean brown lips. Brody backed away from her with his mouth working and an expression of panic on his face. Carmen shut the door behind her and looked neither at me nor at Agnes. She stalked Brody carefully, her tongue sticking out a little between her teeth. Brody took both hands out of his pockets and gestured placatingly at her. His eyebrows designed themselves into an odd assortment of curves and angles. Agnes turned the gun away from me and swung it at Carmen. I shot my hand out and closed my fingers down hard over her hand and jammed my thumb on the safety catch. It was already on. I kept it on. There was a short, silent tussle to which neither Brody nor Carmen paid any attention, whatever. I had the gun. Agnes breathed deeply and shivered the whole length of her body. Carmen's face had a bony, scraped look, and her breath hissed. Her voice said, without tone, "I want my pictures, Joe." Brody swallowed and tried to grin. "Sure, kid, sure," he said in a small, flat voice that was as much like the voice he had used to me as a scooter is like a 10-ton truck. Carmen said, "You shot Arthur Geiger. I saw you. I want my pictures." Brody turned green. "Hey, wait a minute, Carmen," I yelped. Blonde Agnes came to life with a rush. She ducked her head and sank her teeth in my right hand. I made more noises and shook her off. "Listen, kid," Brody whined. "Listen a minute." The blonde spat at me and threw herself on my leg and tried to bite that. I cracked her on the head with the gun, not very hard, and tried to stand up. She rolled down my legs and wrapped her arms around them. I fell back on the davenport. The blonde was strong with the madness of love or fear, or a mixture of both, or maybe she was just strong. Brody grabbed for the little revolver that was so close to his face. He missed. The gun made a sharp rapping noise that was not very loud. The bullet broke glass in a folded back French window. Brody groaned horribly and fell down on the floor and jerked Carmen's feet from under her. She landed in a heap, and the little revolver went skidding off into a corner. Brody jumped up on his knees and reached for his pocket. I hit Agnes on the head with less delicacy than before, kicked her off my feet, and stood up. Brody flicked his eyes at me. I showed him the automatic. He stopped trying to get his hand into his pocket. "Christ," he whined, "don't let her kill me." I began to laugh. I laughed like an idiot without control. Blonde Agnes was sitting up on the floor with her hands flat on the carpet and her mouth wide open and a wick of metallic blonde hair down over her right eye. Carmen was crawling on her hands and knees, still hissing. The metal of her little revolver glistened against the baseboard over in the corner. She crawled towards it relentlessly. I waved my share of the guns at Brody and said, "Stay put. You're all right." I stepped past the crawling girl and picked the gun up. She looked up at me and began to giggle. I put her gun in my pocket and patted her on the back. "Get up, Angel. You look like a Pekingese." I went over to Brody and put the automatic against his midriff and reached his Colt out of his side pocket. I now had all the guns that had been exposed to view. I stuffed them into my pockets and held my hand out to him. "Give," He nodded, licking his lips, his eyes still scared. He took a fat envelope out of his breast pocket and gave it to me. There was a developed plate in the envelope and five glossy prints. Sure these are all? He nodded again. I put the envelope in my own breast pocket and turned away. Agnes was back on the davenport, straightening her hair. Her eyes ate Carmen with a green distillation of hate. Carmen was up on her feet too, coming towards me with her hand out, still giggling and hissing. There was a little froth at the corners of her mouth. Her small white teeth glinted close to her lips. "Can I have them now?" she asked me with a coy smile. "I'll take care of them for you. Go on home." "Home?" I went to the door and looked out. The cool night breeze was blowing peacefully down the hall. No excited neighbors hung out of doorways. A small gun had gone off and broken a pane of glass, but noises like that don't mean much anymore. I held the door open and jerked my head at Carmen. She came towards me, smiling uncertainly. "Go on home and wait for me," I said soothingly. She put her thumb up, then she nodded and slipped past me into the hall. She touched my cheek with her fingers as she went by. "You'll take care of Carmen, won't you?" she cooed. "Check. You're cute." "What you see is nothing," I said. "I've got a Bali dancing girl tattooed on my right thigh." Her eyes rounded. She said, "Naughty," and wagged a finger at me. Then she whispered, "Can I have my gun?" "Not now. Later. I'll bring it to you." She grabbed me suddenly around the neck and kissed me on the mouth. "I like you," she said. "Carmen likes you a lot." She ran off down the hall as gay as a thrush, waved at me from the stairs, and ran down the stairs out of my sight. I went back into Brody's apartment. 16. I went over to the folded back French window and looked at the small broken pane in the upper part of it. The bullet from Carmen's gun had smashed the glass like a blow. It had not made a hole. There was a small hole in the plaster, which a keen eye would find quickly enough. I pulled the drapes over the broken pane and took Carmen's gun out of my pocket. It was a banker's special, 22 caliber, hollow point cartridges. It had a pearl grip and a small round silver plate set into the butt was engraved, "Carmen from Owen." She made saps of all of them. I put the gun back in my pocket and sat down close to Brody and stared into his bleak brown eyes. A minute passed. The blonde adjusted her face by the aid of a pocket mirror. Brody fumbled around with a cigarette and jerked. "Satisfied? So far. Why did you put the bite on Mrs. Reagan instead of the old man?" "Tapped the old man once, about 6-7 months ago. I figure maybe he gets sore enough to call in some law. What made you think Mrs. Reagan wouldn't tell him about it?" He considered that with some care, smoking his cigarette and keeping his eyes on my face. Finally he said, "How well you know her. I've met her twice. You must know her a lot better to take a chance on that squeeze with the photo. She skates around plenty. I figure maybe she has a couple of soft spots she don't want the old man to know about. I figure she can raise $5,000 easy." "A little weak," I said, "but pass it." "You're broke, eh? I've been shaking two nickels together for a month trying to get them to mate." "What you do for a living?" "Insurance. I got desk room in Puss Walgreens' office. Fullwider Building, Western and Santa Monica. When you open up, you open up. The books here in your apartment?" He snapped his teeth and waved a brown hand. Confidence was oozing back into his manner. "Hell no, in storage. You had a man bring them here, and then you had a storage outfit come and take them away again right afterwards?" "Sure, I don't want them moved direct from Geiger's place, do I?" "You're smart," I said admiringly. "Anything incriminating in the joint right now?" He looked worried again. He shook his head sharply. "That's fine," I told him. I looked across at Agnes. She had finished fixing her face and was staring at the wall, blank-eyed, hardly listening. Her face had the drowsiness which strain and shock induce after their first incidents. Brody flicked his eyes warily. "Well, how'd you come by the photo?" He scowled. "Listen, you got what you came after. Got it plenty cheap. You done a nice, neat job. Now go peddle it to your top man. I'm clean. I don't know nothing about any photo, do I, Agnes?" The blonde opened her eyes and looked at him with vague but uncomplimentary speculation. "A half-smart guy," she said with a tired sniff. "That's all I ever draw. Never once a guy that's smart all the way around the course. Never once. I grinned at her. Did I hurt your head much? You and every other man I ever met. I looked back at Brody. He was pinching his cigarette between his fingers with a sort of twitch. His hands seemed to be shaking a little. His brown poker face was still smooth. We've got to agree on a story, I said. For instance, Carmen wasn't here. That's very important. She wasn't here. That was a vision you saw. Huh, Brody sneered. If you say so, pal. And if... He put his hand out, palm up, and cupped the fingers and rolled the thumb gently against the index and middle fingers. I nodded. We'll see. There might be a small contribution. You won't count it in grands, though. Now, where did you get the picture? A guy slipped it to me. A guy you just passed in the street. You wouldn't know him again. You never saw him before. Brody yawned. It dropped out of his pocket, he leered. Got an alibi for last night, poker man? Sure. I was right here. Agnes was with me. Okay, Agnes? I'm beginning to feel sorry for you again, I said. His eyes flicked wide and his mouth hung loose. The cigarette balanced on his lower lip. You think you're smart and you're so goddamn dumb, I told him. Even if you don't dance off up in Quentin, you have such a bleak, long, lonely time ahead of you. His cigarette jerked and dropped ash on his vest. Thinking about how smart you are, I said. Take the air, he growled suddenly. Dust. I got enough chinning with you. Beat it. Okay. I stood up and went over to the tall oak desk and took his two guns out of my pockets, laid them side by side on the blotter so that the barrels were exactly parallel. I reached my hat off the floor beside the davenport and started for the door. Brody yelped. Hey! I turned and waited. His cigarette was jiggling like a doll on a coiled spring. Everything's smooth, ain't it? He asked. Why, sure. This is a free country. You don't have to stay out of jail if you don't want to. That is, if you're a citizen. Are you a citizen? He just stared at me, jiggling the cigarette. The blonde Agnes turned her head slowly and stared at me along the same level. Their glances contained almost the exact same blend of foxiness, doubt, and frustrated anger. Agnes reached her silvery nails up abruptly and yanked a hair out of her head and broke it between her fingers with a bitter jerk. Brody said tightly, "You're not going to any cops, brother." "Not if it's the Sternwoods you're working for. I've got too much stuff on that family. You got your pictures and you got your hush. Go and peddle your papers." "Make your mind up," I said. "You told me to dust. I was on my way out. You hollered at me and I stopped. And now I'm on my way out again. Is that what you want?" "You ain't got anything on me," Brody said. "Just a couple of murders. Small change in your circle." He didn't jump more than an inch, but it looked like a foot. The white cornea showed all around the tobacco-colored iris of his eyes. The brown skin of his face took on a greenish tinge in the lamplight. Blonde Agnes let out a low animal wail and buried her head in a cushion on the end of the davenport. I stood there and admired the long line of her thighs. Brody moistened his lips slowly and said, "Sit down, pal. Maybe I have a little more for you. What's that crack about two murders mean?" I leaned against the door. "Where were you last night? About 7:30, Joe?" His mouth dropped sulkily and he stared down at the floor. "I was watching a guy who had a nice racket I figured he needed a partner in. Geiger. I was watching him now and then to see had he any tough connections. I figure he has friends or he don't work the racket as open as he does, but they don't go to his house, only dames." "You didn't watch hard enough," I said. "Go on." "I'm there last night on the street below Geiger's house. It's raining hard and I'm buttoned up in my coupe and I don't see anything. There's a car in front of Geiger's and another car a little way up the hill. That's why I stay down below. There's a big Buick parked down where I am, and after a while I go over and take a gander into it. It's registered to Vivian Reagan. Nothing happens, so I scram. That's all." He waved his cigarette. His eyes crawled up and down my face. "Could be," I said. "Know where that Buick is now? Why would I? In the sheriff's garage. It was lifted out of 12 feet of water off Lido Fish Pier this AM. There was a dead man in it. He had been sapped, and the car pointed out the pier and the hand throttle pulled down. Brody was breathing hard. One of his feet tapped restlessly. "Jesus, guy, you can't pin that one on me," he said thickly. "Why not? This Buick was down back of Geiger's, according to you. Well, Mrs. Reagan didn't have it out. Her chauffeur, a lad named Owen Taylor, had it out. He went over to Geiger's place to have words with him because Owen Taylor was sweet on Carmen, and he didn't like the kind of games Geiger was playing with her. He let himself in the back way with a jimmy and a gun, and he caught Geiger taking a photo of Carmen without any clothes on. So his gun went off, as guns will, and Geiger fell down dead, and Owen ran away, but not without the photo negative Geiger had just taken. So you ran after him and took the photo from him. How else would you have got hold of it?" Brody licked his lips. "Yeah," he said, "but that don't make me knock him off. Sure, I heard the shots and saw this killer come slamming down the back steps into the Buick and off. I took out after him. He hit the bottom of the canyon and went west on Sunset. Beyond Beverly Hills, he skidded off the road and had to stop, and I came up and played copper. He had a gun, but his nerve was bad, and I sapped him down. So I went through his clothes and found out who he was, and I lifted the plate holder just out of curiosity. I was wondering what it was all about and getting my neck wet when he came out of it all of a sudden and knocked me off the car. He was out of sight when I picked myself up. That's the last I saw of him." "How did you know it was Geiger he shot?" I asked gruffly. Brody shrugged.
"I figure it was, but I could be wrong. When I had the plate developed and saw what was on it, I was pretty damn sure."
"And when Geiger didn't come down to the store this morning and didn't answer his phone, I was plenty sure.
So I figure
it's a good time to move his books out and make a quick touch on the Sternwoods for travel money and blow for a while." I nodded. "That seems reasonable. Maybe you didn't murder anybody at that. Where did you hide Geiger's body?" He jumped his eyebrows. Then he grinned. "Nix, nix. Skip it. You think I'd go back there and handle him, not knowing when a couple of carloads of law would come tearing around the corner? Nix." "Somebody hid the body," I said. Brody shrugged. The grin stayed on his face. He didn't believe me. While he was still not believing me, the door buzzer started to ring again. Brody stood up sharply, hard-eyed. He glanced over at his guns on the desk. "So she's back again," he growled. "If she is, she doesn't have her gun." I comforted him. "Don't you have any other friends?" "Just about one," he growled. "I got enough of this puss in the corner game." He marched to the desk and took the Colt. He held it down to his side and went to the door. He put his left hand to the knob and twisted it and opened the door a foot and leaned into the opening,
holding the gun tight against his thigh.
A voice said, "Brody?" Brody said something I didn't hear. The two quick reports were muffled. The gun must have been pressed tight against Brody's body. He tilted forward against the door, and the weight of his body pushed it shut with a bang. He slid down the wood. His feet pushed the carpet away behind him. His left hand dropped off the knob, and the arm slapped the floor with a thud. His head was wedged against the door. He didn't move. The Colt clung to his right hand. I jumped across the room and rolled him enough to get the door open and crowd through. A woman peered out of a door almost opposite. Her face was full of fright, and she pointed along the hall with a claw-like hand. I raced down the hall and heard thumping feet going down the tile steps and went down after the sound. At the lobby level, the front door was closing itself quietly, and running feet slapped the sidewalk outside. I made the door before it was shut, clawed it open again, and charged out. A tall, hatless figure in a leather jerkin was running diagonally across the street between the parked cars. The figure turned, and flame spurted from it. Two heavy hammers hit the stucco wall beside me. The figure ran on, dodged between two cars, vanished. A man came up beside me and barked. "What happened?" "Shooting going on," I said. "Jesus!" He scuttled into the apartment house. I walked quickly down the sidewalk to my car and got in and started it. I pulled out from the curb and drove down the hill, not fast. No other car started up on the other side of the street. I thought I heard steps, but I wasn't sure about that. I rode down the hill a block and a half, turned at the intersection, and started back up. The sound of a muted whistling came to me faintly along the sidewalk. Then steps. I double parked and slid out between two cars and went down low. I took Carmen's little revolver out of my pocket. The sound of the steps grew louder and the whistling went on cheerfully. In a moment, the jerkin showed. I stepped out between the two cars and said, "Got a match, buddy?" The boy spun towards me and his right hand darted up to go inside the jerkin. His eyes were a wet shine in the glow of the round electroliers. Moist dark eyes shaped like almonds and a pallid handsome face with wavy black hair growing low on the forehead in two points. A very handsome boy indeed, the boy from Geiger's store. He stood there looking at me silently, his right hand on the edge of the jerkin, but not inside it yet. I held the little revolver down at my side. "You must have thought a lot of that, Queen," I said.
"Go fuck yourself," the boy said softly,
motionless between the parked cars and the 5-foot retaining wall on the inside of the sidewalk. A siren wailed distantly coming up the long hill. The boy's head jerked towards the sound. I stepped in close and put my gun into his jerkin. "Me or the cops?" I asked him. His head rolled a little sideways as if I had slapped his face. "Who are you?" he snarled. "Friend of Geiger's." "Get away from me, you son of a bitch. This is a small gun, kid. I'll give it to you through the navel, and it will take 3 months to get you well enough to walk. But you'll get well, so you can walk to the nice new gas chamber up in Quentin." He said, "Go fuck yourself." His hand moved inside the jerkin. I pressed harder on his stomach. He let out a long, soft sigh, took his hand away from the jerkin, and let it fall limp at his side. His wide shoulders sagged. "What you want?" he whispered. I reached inside the jerkin and plucked out the automatic. "Get into my car, kid." He stepped past me, and I crowded him from behind. He got into the car. "Under the wheel, kid. You drive." He slid under the wheel, and I got into the car beside him. I said, "Let the prowl car pass up the hill. They'll think we moved over when we heard the siren. Then turn her downhill, and we'll go home." I put Carmen's gun away and leaned the automatic against the boy's ribs. I looked back through the window. The whine of the siren was very loud now. Two red lights swelled in the middle of the street. They grew larger and blended into one, and the car rushed by in a wild flurry of sound. "Let's go," I said. The boy swung the car and started off down the hill. "Let's go home," I said. "To Laverne Terrace." His smooth lips twitched. He swung the car west on Franklin. "You're a simple-minded lad. What's your name?" "Carol Lundgren," he said lifelessly. "You shot the wrong guy, Carol. Joe Brody didn't kill your queen." He spoke 3 words to me and kept on driving. 17. A moon half gone from the full glowed through a ring of mist among the high branches of the eucalyptus trees on Laverne Terrace. A radio sounded loudly from a house low down the hill. The boy swung the car over to the box hedge in front of Geiger's house, killed the motor, and sat looking straight before him with both hands on the wheel. No light showed through Geiger's hedge. I said, "Anybody home, son?" "You ought to know." "How would I know?" "Go fuck yourself. That's how people get false teeth." He showed me his and a tight grin. Then he kicked the door open and got out. I scuttled out after him. He stood with his fists on his hips, looking silently at the house above the top of the hedge. "All right," I said, "you have a key. Let's go on in." "Who said I had a key?" "Don't kid me, son. The fag gave you one. You've got a nice, clean, manly little room in there. He shooed you out and locked it up when he had lady visitors. He was like Caesar, a husband to women and a wife to men. Think I can't figure people like him and you out?" I still held his automatic more or less pointed at him, but he swung on me just the same. It caught me flush on the chin. I backstepped fast enough to keep from falling, but I took plenty of the punch. It was meant to be a hard one, but a pansy has no iron in his bones, whatever he looks like. I threw the gun down at the kid's feet and said, "Maybe you need this." He stooped for it like a flash. There was nothing slow about his movements. I sank a fist in the side of his neck. He toppled over sideways, clawing for the gun and not reaching it. I picked it up again and threw it in the car. The boy came up on all fours, leering with his eyes too wide open. He coughed and shook his head. "You don't want to fight," I told him. "You're giving away too much weight." He wanted to fight. He shot at me like a plane from a catapult, reaching for my knees in a diving tackle. I sidestepped and reached for his neck and took it into chancery. He scraped the dirt hard and got his feet under him enough to use his hands on me where it hurt. I twisted him around and heaved him a little higher. I took hold of my right wrist with my left hand and turned my right hip bone into him, and for a moment it was a balance of weights. We seemed to hang there in the misty moonlight, two grotesque creatures whose feet scraped on the road and whose breath panted with effort. I had my right forearm against his windpipe now and all the strength of both arms in it. His feet began a frenetic shuffle and he wasn't panting anymore. He was iron-bound. His left foot sprawled off to one side and the knee went slack. I held on half a minute longer. He sagged on my arm, an enormous weight I could hardly hold up. Then I let go. He sprawled at my feet, out cold. I went to the car and got a pair of handcuffs out of the glove compartment and twisted his wrists behind him and snapped them on. I lifted him by the armpits and managed to drag him in behind the hedge, out of sight from the street. I went back to the car and moved it 100 feet up the hill and locked it. He was still out when I got back. I unlocked the door, dragged him into the house, shut the door. He was beginning to gasp now. I switched a lamp on. His eyes fluttered open and focused on me slowly. I bent down, keeping out of the way of his knees, and said, "Keep quiet or you'll get the same and more of it. Just lie quiet and hold your breath. Hold it until you can't hold it any longer, and then tell yourself that you have to breathe, that you're black in the face, that your eyeballs are popping out, and that you're going to breathe right now, but that you're sitting strapped to the chair in the clean little gas chamber up in San Quentin, and when you take that breath, you're fighting with all your soul not to take it. It won't be air you'll get, it will be cyanide fumes, and that's what they call humane execution in our state now." "Go fuck yourself," he said with a soft, stricken sigh. "You're going to cop a plea, brother. Don't ever think you're not. And you're going to say just what we want you to say and nothing we don't want you to say. Go fuck yourself. Say that again and I'll put a pillow under your head." His mouth twitched. I left him lying on the floor with his wrists shackled behind him and his cheek pressed into the rug and an animal brightness in his visible eye. I put on another lamp and stepped into the hallway at the back of the living room. Geiger's bedroom didn't seem to have been touched. I opened the door, not locked now, of the bedroom across the hall from it. There was a dim, flickering light in the room and a smell of sandalwood. Two cones of incense ash stood side by side on a small brass tray on the bureau. The light came from the two tall black candles in the foot-high candlesticks. They were standing on straight-backed chairs, one on either side of the bed. Geiger lay on the bed. The two missing strips of Chinese tapestry made a St. Andrew's cross over the middle of his body, hiding the blood-smeared front of his Chinese coat. Below the cross, his black pajamaed legs lay stiff and straight. His feet were in the slippers with thick white felt soles. Above the cross, his arms were crossed at the wrists and his hands lay flat against his shoulders, palms down, fingers close together and stretched out evenly. His mouth was closed and his Charlie Chan mustache was as unreal as a toupee. His broad nose was pinched and white. His eyes were almost closed, but not entirely. The faint glitter of his glass eye caught the light and winked at me. I didn't touch him. I didn't go very near him. He would be as cold as ice and as stiff as a board. The black candles guttered in the draft from the open door. Drops of black wax crawled down their sides. The air of the room was poisonous and unreal. I went out and shut the door again and went back to the living room. The boy hadn't moved. I stood still, listening for sirens. It was all a question of how soon Agnes talked and what she said. If she talked about Geiger, the police would be there any minute, but she might not talk for hours. She might even have got away. I looked down at the boy. "Want to sit up, son?" He closed his eyes and pretended to go to sleep. I went over to the desk and scooped up the mulberry-colored phone and dialed Bernie Ohl's office. He had left to go home at 6 o'clock. I dialed the number of his home. He was there. "This is Marlowe," I said. "Did your boys find a revolver on Owen Taylor this morning?" I could hear him clearing his throat, and then I could hear him trying to keep the surprise out of his voice. "That would come under the heading of police business," he said. "If they did, it had 3 empty shells in it." "How the hell did you know that?" Ohl's asked quietly. "Come over to 7244 Laverne Terrace off Laurel Canyon Boulevard. I'll show you where the slugs went." "Just like that, huh?" "Just like that," Ohl's said. "Look out the window and you'll see me coming round the corner. I thought you acted a little cagey on that one." "Cagey is no word for it," I said. 18. Ohl's stood looking down at the boy. The boy sat on the couch, leaning sideways against the wall. Ohl's looked at him silently, his pale eyebrows bristling and stiff and round, like the little vegetable brushes the Fuller brush man gives away. He asked the boy, "Do you admit shooting Brody?" The boy said his favorite 3 words in a muffled voice. Ohl's sighed and looked at me. I said, "He doesn't have to admit that. I have his gun." Ohl's said, "I wish to Christ I had a dollar for every time I've had that said to me. What's funny about it?" "It's not meant to be funny," I said. "Well, that's something," Ohl's said. He turned away. "I've called Wild. We'll go over and see him and take this punk. He can ride with me and you can follow on behind in case he tries to kick me in the face. How do you like what's in the bedroom?" "I like it fine," Ohl said. "I'm glad of that. I'm kind of glad that Taylor kid went off the pier. I'd hate to have to help send him to the death house for rubbing that skunk." I went back into the small bedroom and blew out the black candles and let them smoke. When I got back to the living room, Ohl's had the boy up on his feet. The boy stood glaring at him with sharp black eyes and a face as hard and white as cold mutton fat. "Let's go," Ohl's said, and took him by the arm as if he didn't like touching him. I put the lamps out and followed them out of the house. We got into our cars and I followed Ohl's twin tail lights down the long curving hill. I hoped this would be my last trip to Laverne Terrace. Taggart Wild, the district attorney, lived at the corner of 4th and Lafayette Park in a white frame house the size of a car barn with a red sandstone porte cochere built onto one side and a couple of acres of soft rolling lawn in front. It was one of those solid, old-fashioned houses which it used to be the thing to move bodily to new locations as the city grew westward. Wild came of an old Los Angeles family and had probably been born in the house when it was on West Adams or Figueroa or St. James Park. There were 2 cars in the driveway already, a big private sedan and a police car with a uniformed chauffeur who leaned smoking against his rear fender and admired the moon. Ohl's went over and spoke to him, and the chauffeur looked at the boy in Ohl's car. We went up to the house and rang the bell. A slick-haired blonde man opened the door and led us down the hall and through a huge sunken living room crowded with heavy dark furniture and along another hall on the far side of it. He knocked at a door and stepped inside, then held the door wide, and we went into a paneled study with an open French door at the end and a view of dark garden and mysterious trees. A smell of wet earth and flowers came in at the window. There were large dim oils on the walls, easy chairs, books, a smell of good cigar smoke which blended with the smell of wet earth and flowers. Taggart Wilde sat behind a desk, a middle-aged plump man with clear blue eyes that managed to have a friendly expression without really having any expression at all. He had a cup of black coffee in front of him, and he held a dappled thin cigar between the neat, careful fingers of his left hand. Another man sat at the corner of the desk in a blue leather chair, a cold-eyed, hatchet-faced man, as lean as a rake and as hard as a manager of a loan office. His neat, well-kept face looked as if it had been shaved within the hour. He wore a well-pressed brown suit, and there was a black pearl in his tie. He had the long, nervous fingers of a man with a quick brain. He looked ready for a fight. Oles pulled a chair up and sat down and said, "Evening, Kronjäger. Meet Phil Marlowe, a private eye who's in a jam." Oles grinned. Kronjäger looked at me without nodding. He looked me over as if he was looking at a photograph. Then he nodded his chin about an inch. Wilde said, "Sit down, Marlowe. I'll try to handle Captain Kronjäger, but you know how it is. This is a big city now." I sat down and lit a cigarette. Oles looked at Kronjäger and asked, "What did you get on the Randall Place killing?" The hatchet-faced man pulled one of his fingers until the knuckle cracked. He spoke without looking up. "A stiff, two slugs in him. Two guns that hadn't been fired. Down on the street we got a blonde trying to start a car that didn't belong to her. Hers was right next to it. Same model. She acted rattled, so the boys brought her in and she spilled. She was in there when this guy Brody got it. Claimed she didn't see the killer." "That all?" Oles asked. Kronjäger raised his eyebrows a little. "Only happened about an hour ago. What'd you expect? Moving pictures of the killing?"
"Maybe a description of the killer," Oles said.
"A tall guy in a leather jerkin, if you call that a description." "He's outside in my heap," Oles said. "Handcuffed. Marlowe put the arm on him for you. Here's his gun." Oles took the boy's automatic out of his pocket and laid it in a corner of Wilde's desk. Kronjäger looked at the gun but didn't reach for it. Wilde chuckled. He was leaning back and puffing his dappled cigar without letting go of it. He bent forward to sip from his coffee cup. He took a silk handkerchief from the breast pocket of the dinner jacket he was wearing and touched his lips with it and tucked it away again. "There's a couple more deaths involved," Oles said, pinching the soft flesh at the end of his chin. Kronjäger stiffened visibly. His surly eyes became points of steely light. Oles said, "You heard about a car being lifted out of the Pacific Ocean off Lido Pier this a.m. with a dead guy in it?" Kronjäger said no and kept on looking nasty. "The dead guy in the car was chauffeur to a rich family," Oles said. "The family was being blackmailed on account of one of the daughters. Mr. Wilde recommended Marlowe to the family through me. Marlowe played it kind of close to the vest." "I love private dicks that play murder close to the vest," Kronjäger snarled. "You don't have to be so goddamned coy about it." "Yeah," Oles said, "I don't have to be so goddamned coy about it. It's not so goddamned often I get a chance to be coy with a city copper. I spend most of my time telling them where to put their feet so they won't break an ankle." Kronjäger whitened around the corners of his sharp nose. His breath made a soft hissing sound in the quiet room. He said very quietly, "You haven't had to tell any of my men where to put their feet, smart guy."
"We'll see about that," Oles said. "The chauffeur I spoke of that's drowned off Lido shot a guy last night in your territory. A guy named Geiger who ran a dirty book racket in a store on Hollywood Boulevard. Geiger was living with the punk I got outside in my car. I mean living with him, if you get the idea."
Kronjäger was staring at him levelly now. "That sounds like it might grow up to be a dirty story," he said.
"It's my experience most police stories are," Oles growled and turned to me, his eyebrows bristling. "You're in the air, Marlowe. Give it to him." I gave it to him. I left out two things, not knowing just why. At the moment, I left out one of them.
I left out Carmen's visit to Brody's apartment and Eddie Mars's visit to Geiger's in the afternoon. I told the rest of it just as it happened. Kronjäger never took his eyes off my face, and no expression of any kind crossed his as I talked. At the end of it, he was perfectly silent for a long minute. Wild was silent, sipping his coffee, puffing gently at his dappled cigar. Old stared at one of his thumbs. Kronjäger leaned slowly back in his chair and crossed one ankle over his knee and rubbed the ankle bone with his thin, nervous hand. His lean face wore a harsh frown. He said with deadly politeness,
"So all you did was not report a murder that happened last night and then spend today foxing around so that this kid of Geiger's could commit a second murder this evening."
"That's all," I said. "I was in a pretty tough spot. I guess I did wrong, but I wanted to protect my client, and I hadn't any reason to think the boy would go running for Brody." "That kind of thinking is police business, Marlowe. If Geiger's death had been reported last night, the books could never have been moved from the store to Brody's apartment. The kid wouldn't have led to Brody and wouldn't have killed him. Say Brody was living on borrowed time. His kind usually are. But a life is a life."
"Right," I said. "Tell that to your coppers next time they shoot down some scared petty larceny crook running away up an alley with a stolen spare."
Wild put both his hands down on his desk with a solid smack.
"That's enough of that," he snapped. "What makes you so sure, Marlowe, that this Taylor boy shot Geiger? Even if the gun that killed Geiger was found on Taylor's body in the car, it doesn't absolutely follow that he was the killer. The gun might have been planted, say by Brody, the actual killer."
"It's physically possible," I said, "but morally impossible. It assumes too much coincidence and too much that's out of character for Brody and his girl, and out of character for what he was trying to do. I talked to Brody for a long time. He was a crook, but not a killer type. He had two guns, but he wasn't wearing either of them. He was trying to find a way to cut in on Geiger's racket, which naturally he knew all about from the girl. He says he was watching Geiger off and on to see if he had any tough backers. I believe him. To suppose he killed Geiger in order to get his books, then scrammed with the nude photo Geiger had just taken of Carmen Sternwood, then planted the gun on Owen Taylor and pushed Taylor into the ocean off Lido is to suppose a hell of a lot too much. Taylor had the motive, jealous rage, and the opportunity to kill Geiger. He was out in one of the family cars without permission. He killed Geiger right in front of the girl, which Brody would never have done, even if he had been a killer. I can't see anybody with a purely commercial interest in Geiger doing that, but Taylor would have done it. The nude photo business was just what would have made him do it." Wild chuckled and looked along his eyes at Kronjäger. Kronjäger cleared his throat with a snort. Wild asked, "What's this business about hiding the body? I don't see the point of that." I said, "The kid hasn't told us, but he must have done it. Brody wouldn't have gone into the house after Geiger was shot. The boy must have got home when I was away taking Carmen to her house. He was afraid of the police, of course, being what he is, and he probably thought it a good idea to have the body hidden until he had removed his effects from the house. He dragged it out of the front door, judging by the marks on the rug, and very likely put it in the garage. Then he packed up whatever belongings he had there and took them away. And later on, sometime in the night, and before the body stiffened, he had a revulsion of feeling and thought he hadn't treated his dead friend very nicely, so he went back and laid him out on the bed. That's all guessing, of course." Wild nodded.
"Then this morning he goes down to the store as if nothing had happened and keeps his eyes open. And when Brody moves the books out, he found out where they were going and assumed that whoever got them had killed Geiger just for that purpose. He may even have known more about Brody and the girl than they suspected. What do you think, Oles?"
Oles said, "We'll find out, but that doesn't help Kronjäger's troubles. What's eating him is all this happened last night, and he's only just been rung in on it," Kronjäger said sourly.
"I think I can find some way to deal with that angle, too." He looked at me sharply and immediately looked away again.
Wilde waved his cigar and said, "Let's see the exhibits, Marlowe." I emptied my pockets and put the catch on his desk. The three notes and Geiger's card to General Sternwood, Carmen's photos, and the blue notebook with the list of names and addresses. I had already given Geiger's keys to Oles. Wilde looked at what I gave him, puffing gently at his cigar. Oles lit one of his own toy cigars and blew smoke peacefully at the ceiling. Kronjäger leaned on the desk and looked at what I had given Wilde. Wilde tapped the three notes signed by Carmen and said, "I guess these were just a come-on. If General Sternwood paid them, it would be through fear of something worse."
"Then Geiger would have tightened the screws. Do you know what he was afraid of?" He was looking at me. I shook my head. "Have you told your story complete in all relevant details? I left out a couple of personal matters. I intend to keep on leaving them out, Mr. Wilde." Kronjäger said, "Ha!" and snorted with deep feeling. "Why?" Wilde asked quietly. "Because my client is entitled to that protection, short of anything but a grand jury. I have a license to operate as a private detective. I suppose the word private has some meaning. The Hollywood division has two murders on its hands, both solved. They have both killers. They have the motive, the instrument, in each case. The blackmail angle has got to be suppressed as far as the names of the parties are concerned." "Why?" Wilde asked again. "That's okay," Kronjäger said dryly. "We're glad to stooge for a Seamus of his standing." I said, "I'll show you." I got up and went back out of the house to my car and got the book from Geiger's store out of it. The uniformed police driver was standing beside Ole's car. The boy was inside it, leaning back sideways in the corner. "Has he said anything?" I asked. "He made a suggestion," the copper said, and spat. "I'm letting it ride." I went back into the house, put the book on Wilde's desk, and opened up the wrappings. Kronjäger was using a telephone on the end of the desk. He hung up and sat down as I came in. Wilde looked through the book, wooden-faced, closed it, and pushed it towards Kronjäger. Kronjäger opened it, looked at a page or two, shut it quickly. A couple of red spots the size of half dollars showed on his cheekbones. I said, "Look at the stamped dates on the front end paper." Kronjäger opened the book again and looked at them. "Well, if necessary," I said, "I'll testify under oath that that book came from Geiger's store. The blonde, Agnes, will admit what kind of business the store did. It's obvious to anybody with eyes that that store is just a front for something. But the Hollywood police allowed it to operate for their own reasons. I dare say the grand jury would like to know what those reasons are." Wilde grinned. He said, "Grand juries do ask those embarrassing questions sometimes, in a rather vain effort to find out just why cities are run as they are run." Kronjäger stood up suddenly and put his hat on. "I'm one against three here," he snapped. "I'm a homicide man. If this Geiger was running indecent literature, that's no skin off my nose. But I'm ready to admit it won't help my division any to have it washed over in the papers. What do you birds want?" Wilde looked at Oles. Oles said calmly, "I want to turn a prisoner over to you. Let's go." He stood up. Kronjäger looked at him fiercely and stalked out of the room. Oles went after him. The door closed again. Wilde tapped on his desk and stared at me with his clear blue eyes. "You ought to understand how any copper would feel about a cover-up like this," he said. "You'll have to make statements of all of it, at least for the files. I think it may be possible to keep the two killings separate and to keep General Sternwood's name out of both of them. Do you know why I'm not tearing your ear off?" "No, I expected to get both ears torn off." "What are you getting for it all?" $25 a day and expenses." "That would make $50 and a little gasoline so far. About that,
He put his head on one side and rubbed the back of his left little finger along the lower edge of his chin.
And for that amount of money, you're willing to get yourself in Dutch with half the law enforcement of this county?
I don't like it, I said, but what the hell am I to do? I'm on a case. I'm selling what I have to sell to make a living. What little guts and intelligence the Lord gave me and a willingness to get pushed around in order to protect a client. It's against my principles to tell as much as I've told tonight without consulting the general. As for the cover-up, I've been in police business myself, as you know. They come a dime a dozen in any big city. Cops get very large and emphatic when an outsider tries to hide anything, but they do the same things themselves every other day to oblige their friends or anybody with a little pull. And I'm not through. I'm still on the case. I'd do the same thing again if I had to. Providing Kronjäger doesn't get your license, Wild grinned. You said you held back a couple of personal matters. Of what import?
I'm still on the case, I said, and stared straight into his eyes.
Wild smiled at me. He had the frank, daring smile of an Irishman. Let me tell you something, son. My father was a close friend of old Sternwood. I've done all my office permits, and maybe a good deal more, to save the old man from grief. But in the long run, it can't be done. Those girls of his are bound certain to hook up with something that can't be hushed, especially that little blonde brat. They ought not to be running around loose. I blame the old man for that. I guess he doesn't realize what the world is today. And there's another thing I might mention while we're talking man to man, and I don't have to growl at you. I'll bet a dollar to a Canadian dime that the general's afraid his son-in-law, the ex-bootlegger, is mixed up in this somewhere. And what he really hoped you would find out is that he isn't. What do you think of that? Reagan didn't sound like a blackmailer, what I heard of him. He had a soft spot where he was, and he walked out on it. Wild snorted. The softness of that spot neither you nor I could judge. If he was a certain sort of man, it would not have been so very soft. Did the general tell you he was looking for Reagan? He told me he wished he knew where he was, and that he was all right. He liked Reagan and was hurt the way he bounced off without telling the old man goodbye. Wild leaned back and frowned. I see, he said in a changed voice. His hand moved the stuff on his desk around, laid Geiger's blue notebook to one side, and pushed the other exhibits toward me. You may as well take these, he said. I've no further use for them.
19.
It was close to 11 when I put my car away and walked around to the front of the Hobart Arms. The plate glass door was put up on the lock at 10, so I had to get my keys out. Inside, in the square, barren lobby, a man put a green evening paper down beside a potted palm and flicked a cigarette butt into the tub the palm grew in. He stood up and waved his hat at me and said, "The boss wants to talk to you. You sure keep your friends waiting, pal."
I stood still and looked at his flattened nose and clubsteak ear.
"What about?"
"What do you care? Just keep your nose clean and everything will be Jake." His hand hovered near the upper buttonhole of his open coat.
"I smell of policemen," I said. "I'm too tired to talk, too tired to eat, too tired to think. But if you think I'm not too tired to take orders from Eddie Mars, try getting your gat out before I shoot your good ear off."
"Nuts, you ain't got no gun." He stared at me levelly. His dark, wiry brows closed in together, and his mouth made a downward curve.
"That was then," I told him. "I'm not always naked." He waved his left hand.
"Okay, you win. I wasn't told to blast anybody. You'll hear from him."
"Too late will be too soon," I said, and turned slowly as he passed me on his way to the door. He opened it and went out without looking back. I grinned at my own foolishness, went along to the elevator and upstairs to the apartment. I took Carmen's little gun out of my pocket and laughed at it. Then I cleaned it thoroughly, oiled it, wrapped it in a piece of Canton flannel, and locked it up.
I made myself a drink and was drinking it when the phone rang. I sat down beside the table on which it stood.
So you're tough tonight, Eddie Mars's voice said.
Big, fast, tough, and full of prickles. What can I do for you? Cops over there. You know where. You keep me out of it? Why should I? I'm nice to be nice to, soldier. I'm not nice not to be nice to. Listen hard and you'll hear my teeth chattering. He laughed dryly. Did you or did you? I did. I'm damned if I know why. I guess it was just complicated enough without you. Thanks, soldier. Who gunned him? Read it in the paper tomorrow, maybe. I want to know now. Do you get everything you want? No. Is that an answer, soldier? Somebody you never heard of gunned him. Let it go at that. If that's on the level, someday I may be able to do you a favor. Hang up and let me go to bed. He laughed again. You're looking for Rusty Reagan, aren't you? A lot of people seem to think I am, but I'm not. If you were, I could give you an idea. Drop in and see me down at the beach. Anytime. Glad to see you. Maybe. Be seeing you then.
The phone clicked and I sat holding it with a savage patience.
Then I dialed the Sternwood's number and heard it ring 4 or 5 times, and then the butler's suave voice saying, General Sternwood's residence.
This is Marlowe. Remember me? I met you about 100 years ago, or was it yesterday?
Yes, Mr. Marlowe, I remember, of course.
Is Mrs. Reagan home?
Yes, I believe so. Would you...
I cut in on him with a sudden change of mind.
No, you give her the message. Tell her I have the pictures, all of them, and that everything is all right. Yes. Yes, the voice seemed to shake a little. You have the pictures, all of them, and everything is all right. Yes, sir, I may say thank you very much, sir. The phone rang back in 5 minutes. I had finished my drink, and it made me feel as if I could eat the dinner I had forgotten all about. I went out, leaving the telephone ringing. It was ringing when I came back. It rang at intervals until 12:30. At that time, I put my lights out and opened the windows and
muffled the phone bell with a piece of paper and went to bed. I had a bellyful of the Sternwood family.
I read all 3 of the morning papers over my eggs and bacon the next morning. Their accounts of the affair came as close to the truth as newspaper stories usually come, as close as Mars is to Saturn. None of the 3 connected Owen Taylor, driver of the Lido Pier suicide car, with the Laurel Canyon exotic bungalow slaying. None of them mentioned the Sternwoods, Bernie Oles, or me. Owen Taylor was chauffeur to a wealthy family. Captain Kronjager of the Hollywood Division got all the credit for solving the 2 slayings in his district, which were supposed to arise out of a dispute over the proceeds from a wire service maintained by one Geiger in the back of the bookstore on Hollywood Boulevard. Brody had shot Geiger, and Carol Lundgren had shot Brody in revenge. Police were holding Carol Lundgren in custody. He had confessed. He had a bad record, probably in high school. Police were also holding one Agnes Lozell, Geiger's secretary, as a material witness. It was a nice write-up. It gave the impression that Geiger had been killed the night before, that Brody had been killed about an hour later, and that Captain Kronjager had solved both murders while lighting a cigarette. The suicide of Taylor made page 1 of section 2. There was a photo of the sedan on the deck of the power lighter with the license plate blacked out and something covered with a cloth lying on the deck beside the running board. Owen Taylor had been despondent and in poor health. His family lived in Dubuque, and his body would be shipped there. There would be no inquest. 20. Captain Gregory of the Missing Persons Bureau laid my card down on his wide, flat desk and arranged it so that its edges exactly paralleled the edges of the desk. He studied it with his head on one side, grunted, swung around in his swivel chair, and looked out of his window at the barred top floor of the Hall of Justice half a block away. He was a burly man with tired eyes and the slow, deliberate movements of a night watchman. His voice was toneless, flat, and uninterested. "Private Dick, eh?" he said, not looking at me at all, but looking out of his window. Smoke wisped from the blackened bowl of a briar that hung on his eye tooth. "What can I do for you?" "I'm working for General Guy Sternwood, 3765 Altabrea Crescent, West Hollywood." Captain Gregory blew a little smoke from the corner of his mouth without removing the pipe.
"On what?"
"Not exactly on what you're working on, but I'm interested. I thought you could help me."
"Help you on what?"
"General Sternwood's a rich man," I said. "He's an old friend of the DA's father. If he wants to hire a full-time boy to run errands for him, that's no reflection on the police. It's just a luxury he is able to afford himself."
"What makes you think I'm doing anything for him?"
I didn't answer that. He swung around slowly and heavily in his swivel chair and put his large feet flat on the bare linoleum that covered his floor. His office had the musty smell of years of routine. He stared at me bleakly. "I don't want to waste your time, Captain," I said, and pushed my chair back about 4 inches. He didn't move. He kept on staring at me out of his washed-out, tired eyes.
"You know the DA?"
"I've met him. I worked for him once. I know Bernie Oles, his chief investigator, pretty well." Captain Gregory reached for a phone and mumbled into it, "Get me Oles at the DA's office." He sat holding the phone down on its cradle. Moments passed. Smoke drifted from his pipe. His eyes were heavy and motionless like his hand. The bell tinkled and he reached for my card with his left hand.
"Oles? Al Gregory at headquarters. A guy named Philip Marlowe is in my office. His card says he's a private investigator. He wants information from me." "Yeah? What does he look like?" "Okay, thanks."
He dropped the phone and took his pipe out of his mouth and tamped the tobacco with the brass cap of a heavy pencil. He did it carefully and solemnly, as if that was as important as anything he would have to do that day. He leaned back and stared at me some more.
"What do you want?"
"An idea of what progress you're making, if any." He thought that over.
"Reagan?" he asked finally.
"Sure."
"Know him?"
"I never saw him. I hear he's a good-looking Irishman in his late 30s, that he was once in the liquor racket, that he married General Sternwood's older daughter, and that they didn't click."
"I'm told he disappeared about a month back."
"Sternwood ought to think himself lucky instead of hiring private talent to beat around in the tall grass."
"The general took a big fancy to him. Such things happen. The old man is crippled and lonely. Reagan used to sit around with him and keep him company."
"What do you think you can do that we can't do?"
"Nothing at all, insofar as finding Reagan goes. But there's a rather mysterious blackmail angle."
"I want to make sure Reagan isn't involved."
"Knowing where he is or isn't might help."
"Brother, I'd like to help you, but I don't know where he is."
"He pulled down the curtain, and that's that."
"Pretty hard to do against your organization, isn't it, Captain?"
"Yeah, but it can be done, for a while."
He touched a bell button on the side of his desk. A middle-aged woman put her head in at a side door.
"Get me the file on Terrence Reagan, Abba."
The door closed. Captain Gregory and I looked at each other in some more heavy silence. The door opened again, and the woman put a tabbed green file on his desk. Captain Gregory nodded her out, put a pair of heavy horn-rimmed glasses on his veined nose, and turned the papers in the file over slowly. I rolled a cigarette around in my fingers.
"He blew on the 16th of September," he said.
The only thing important about that is it was the chauffeur's day off, and nobody saw Reagan take his car out. It was late afternoon, though. We found the car 4 days later in a garage belonging to a ritzy bungalow court place near the Sunset Towers. A garage man reported it to the stolen car detail, said it didn't belong there. The place is called the Casa de Oro. There's an angle to that I'll tell you about in a minute. We couldn't find out anything about who put the car in there. We print the car, but don't find any prints that are on file anywhere. The car and that garage don't jibe with foul play, although there's a reason to suspect foul play. It jibes with something else I'll tell you about in a minute, I said. That jibes with Eddie Mars's wife being on the missing list. He looked around. Yeah, we investigate the tenants and find she's living there. Left about the time Reagan did, within 2 days anyway. A guy who sounds a bit like Reagan had been seen with her, but we don't get a positive identification. It's goddamn funny in this police racket how an old woman can look out of a window and see a guy running and pick him out of a lineup 6 months later, but we can show hotel help a clear photo and they just can't be sure. That's one of the qualifications for good hotel help, I said. Yeah, Eddie Mars and his wife didn't live together, but they were friendly, Eddie says. Here's some of the possibilities. First off, Reagan carried $15,000, packed it in his clothes all the time. Real money, they tell me, not just a top card and a bunch of hay. That's a lot of jack, but this Reagan might be the boy to have it around so he could take it out and look at it when somebody was looking at him. Then again, maybe he wouldn't give a damn. His wife says he never made a nickel off old man Sternwood except room and board and a Packard 120 his wife gave him. Tie that for an ex-legger in the rich gravy. It beats me, I said.
Well, here we are with a guy who ducks out and has $15,000 in his pants and folks know it. Well, that's money. I might duck out myself if I had $15,000. And me with 2 kids in high school. So the first thought is somebody rolls him for it and rolls him too hard, so they have to take him out in the desert and plant him among the cactuses. But I don't like that too well. Reagan carried a gat and had plenty of experience using it, and not just in a greasy-faced liquor mob. I understand he commanded a whole brigade in the Irish Troubles back in 1922 or whenever it was. A guy like that wouldn't be white meat to a heister. Then his car being in that garage makes whoever rolled him know he was sweet on Eddie Mars's wife, which he was, I guess. But it ain't something every poolroom bum would know. Got a photo? I asked. Him, not her. That's funny, too. There's a lot of funny angles to this case. Here. He pushed a shiny print across the desk, and I looked at an Irish face that was more sad than merry and more reserved than brash.
Not the face of a tough guy, and not the face of a man who could be pushed around much by anybody.
Straight, dark brows with strong bone under them. A forehead wide rather than high, a mat of dark, clustering hair, a thin, short nose, a wide mouth, a chin that had strong lines but was small for the mouth, a face that looked a little taut, the face of a man who would move fast and play for keeps. I passed the print back. I would know that face if I saw it. Captain Gregory knocked his pipe out and refilled it and tamped the tobacco down with his thumb. He lit it, blew smoke, and began to talk again. Well, there could be people who would know he was sweet on Eddie Mars's frau, besides Eddie himself. For a wonder he knew it. But he don't seem to give a damn. We check him pretty thoroughly around that time. Of course, Eddie wouldn't have knocked him off out of jealousy. The setup would point to him too obvious. It depends how smart he is, I said. He might try the double bluff. Captain Gregory shook his head. If he's smart enough to get by in his racket, he's too smart for that. I get your idea. He pulls the dumb play because he thinks we wouldn't expect him to pull the dumb play. For a police angle, that's wrong. Because he'd have us in his hair so much it would interfere with his business. You might think a dumb play would be smart. I might think so. The rank and file wouldn't. They'd make his life miserable. I've ruled it out. If I'm wrong, you can prove it on me and I'll eat my chair cushion.
Till then, I'm leaving Eddie in the clear. Jealousy is a bad motive for his type. Top-flight racketeers have business brains. They learn to do things that are good policy and let their personal feelings take care of themselves. I'm leaving that out. What are you leaving in? The dame and Reagan himself, nobody else. She was a blonde then, but she won't be now. We don't find her car, so they probably left in it. They had a long start on us, 14 days. Except for that car of Reagan's, I don't figure we'd have got the case at all. Of course, I'm used to them that way, especially in good class families. And of course, everything I've done has had to be under the hat. He leaned back and thumped the arms of his chair with the heels of his large, heavy hands. I don't see nothing to do but wait, he said. We've got readers out, but it's too soon to look for results. Reagan had 15 grand, we know of. The girl had some, maybe a lot in rocks. But they'll run out of dough someday. Reagan will cash a check, drop a marker, write a letter. They're in a strange town, and they've got new names, but they've got the same old appetites. They got to get back in the fiscal system. What did the girl do before she married Eddie Mars? Torture. Can't you get any old professional photos? No, Eddie must have had some, but he won't loosen up. He wants her, let alone. I can't make him. He's got friends in town, or he wouldn't be what he is. He grunted. Any of this do you any good? I said. You'll never find either of them. The Pacific Ocean is too close. What I said about my chair cushion still goes. We'll find him. It may take time. It could take a year or two. General Sternwood may not live that long, I said. We've done all we could, brother. If he wants to put out a reward and spend some money, we might get results. The city don't give me the kind of money it takes. His large eyes peered at me and his scratchy eyebrows moved. You serious about thinking Eddie put them both down? I laughed. No, I was just kidding. I think what you think, Captain, that Reagan ran away with a woman who meant more to him than a rich wife he didn't get along with. Besides, she isn't rich yet. You met her, I suppose? Yes, she'd make a jazzy weekend, but she'd be wearing for a steady diet. He grunted, and I thanked him for his time and information and left. A gray Plymouth sedan tailed me away from the city hall. I gave it a chance to catch up with me on a quiet street. It refused the offer, so I shook it off and went about my business. 21. I didn't go near the Sternwood family. I went back to the office and sat in my swivel chair and tried to catch up on my foot dangling. There was a gusty wind blowing in at the windows, and the soot from the oil burners of the hotel next door was downdrafted into the room and rolling across the top of the desk like tumbleweed drifting across a vacant lot. I was thinking about going out to lunch, and that life was pretty flat, and that it would probably be just as flat if I took a drink, and that taking a drink all alone at that time of day wouldn't be any fun anyway. I was thinking this when Norris called up. In his carefully polite manner, he said that General Sternwood was not feeling very well, and that certain items in the newspaper had been read to him, and he assumed that my investigation was now completed. Yes, as regards Geiger, I said. I didn't shoot him, you know. The general didn't suppose you did, Mr. Marlowe. Does the general know anything about those photographs Mrs. Reagan was worrying about? No, sir, decidedly not. Did you know what the general gave me? Yes, sir, 3 notes and a card, I believe. Right. I'll return them. As to the photos, I think I'd better just destroy them.
Very good, sir. Mrs. Reagan tried to reach you a number of times last night.
I was out getting drunk, I said.
Yes, very necessary, sir, I'm sure. The general has instructed me to send you a check for $500. Will that be satisfactory?
More than generous, I said, and I presume we may now consider the incident closed?
Oh, sure. Tight as a vault with a busted time lock.
Thank you, sir. I am sure we all appreciate it.
When the general is feeling a little better, possibly tomorrow, he would like to thank you in person.
Fine, I said. I'll come out and drink some more of his brandy, maybe with champagne.
I shall see that some is properly iced, the old boy said, almost with a smirk in his voice.
That was that. We said goodbye and hung up.
The coffee shop smell from next door came in at the windows with the soot, but failed to make me hungry.
So I got out my office bottle and took the drink and let my self-respect ride its own race. I counted it up on my fingers. Rusty Reagan had run away from a lot of money and a handsome wife to go wandering with a vague blonde who was more or less married to a racketeer named Eddie Mars. He had gone suddenly without goodbyes, and there might be any number of reasons for that. The general had been too proud, or at the first interview he gave me, too careful to tell me the missing persons bureau had the matter in hand. The missing persons people were dead on their feet on it and evidently didn't think it worth bothering over what Reagan had done, and that was his business. I agreed with Captain Gregory that Eddie Mars would have been very unlikely to involve himself in a double murder just because another man had gone to town with the blonde he was not even living with. It might have annoyed him, but business is business, and you have to hold your teeth clamped around Hollywood to keep from chewing on stray blondes. If there had been a lot of money involved, that would be different. But 15 grand wouldn't be a lot of money to Eddie Mars. He was no two-bit chiseler like Brody.
Geiger was dead, and Carmen would have to find some other shady character to drink exotic blends of hooch with. I didn't suppose she would have any trouble. All she would have to do would be to stand on the corner for 5 minutes and look coy. I hoped that the next grifter who dropped the hook on her would play her a little more smoothly, a little more for the long haul rather than the quick touch. Mrs. Reagan knew Eddie Mars well enough to borrow money from him. That was natural if she played roulette and was a good loser. Any gambling house owner would lend a good client money in a pinch. Apart from this, they had an added bond of interest to Reagan. He was her husband, and he had gone off with Eddie Marr's wife. Carol Lundgren, the boy killer with the limited vocabulary, was out of circulation for a long, long time, even if they didn't strap him in a chair over a bucket of acid. They wouldn't, because he would take a plea and save the county money. They all do when they don't have the price of a big lawyer. Agnes Lozell was in custody as a material witness. They wouldn't need her for that if Carol took a plea, and if he pleaded guilty on arraignment, they would turn her loose. They wouldn't want to open up any angles on Geiger's business, apart from which they had nothing on her. That left me. I had concealed a murder and suppressed evidence for 24 hours, but I was still at large and had a $500 check coming. The smart thing for me to do was to take another drink and forget the whole mess. That being the obviously smart thing to do, I called Eddie Mars and told him I was coming down to Las Olindas that evening to talk to him. That was how smart I was. I got down there about 9, under a hard, high October moon that lost itself in the top layers of a beach fog. The Cypress Club was at the far end of the town, a rambling frame mansion that had once been the summer residence of a rich man named De Cazens and later had been a hotel. It was now a big, dark, outwardly shabby place in a thick grove of wind-twisted Monterey cypresses, which gave it its name. It had enormous scrolled porches, turrets all over the place, stained glass trims around the big windows, big empty stables at the back, a general air of nostalgic decay. Eddie Mars had left the outside much as he had found it, instead of making it over to look like an MGM set. I left my car on a street with sputtering arc lights and walked into the grounds along a damp gravel path to the main entrance. A doorman in a double-breasted guard's coat let me into a huge, dim, silent lobby from which a white oak staircase curved majestically up to the darkness of an upper floor. I checked my hat and coat and waited, listening to music and confused voices behind heavy double doors. They seemed a long way off and not quite of the same world as the building itself. Then the slim, pasty-faced blonde man who had been with Eddie Mars and the pug at Geiger's place came through a door under the staircase, smiled at me bleakly, and took me back with him along a carpeted hall to the boss's office. This was a square room with a deep old bay window and stone fireplace in which a fire of juniper logs burned lazily. It was wainscoted in walnut and had a frieze of faded damask above the paneling. The ceiling was high and remote. There was a smell of cold sea. Eddie Mars' dark, sheenless desk didn't belong in the room, but neither did anything made after 1900. His carpet had a Florida suntan. There was a bar-top radio in the corner and a Sevres China tea set on a copper tray beside a samovar. I wondered who that was for. There was a door in the corner that had a time lock on it. Eddie Mars grinned at me sociably and shook hands and moved his chin at the vault. "I'm a pushover for a heist mob here, except for that thing," he said cheerfully. "The local Johns drop in every morning and watch me open it. I have an arrangement with them."
"You hinted you had something for me," I said. "What is it?"
"What's your hurry? Have a drink and sit down."
"No hurry at all. You and I haven't anything to talk about but business."
"You'll have the drink and like it," he said. He mixed a couple and put mine down beside a red leather chair and stood cross-legged against the desk himself, one hand in the side pocket of his midnight blue dinner jacket, the thumb outside and the nail glistening. In dinner clothes, he looked a little harder than in gray flannel, but he still looked like a horseman. We drank and nodded at each other. "Ever been here before?" he asked.
"During Prohibition, I don't get any kick out of gambling."
"Not with money," he smiled. "You ought to look in tonight. One of your friends is out betting the wheels. I hear she's doing pretty well. Vivian Reagan."
I sipped my drink and took one of his monogrammed cigarettes.
"I kind of liked the way you handled that yesterday," he said. "You made me sore at the time, but I could see afterwards how right you were. You and I ought to get along. How much do I owe you?"
"For doing what?"
"Still careful, eh? I have my pipeline into headquarters, or I wouldn't be here. I get them the way they happen. Not the way you read them in the papers." He showed me his large white teeth.
"How much have you got?" I asked.
"You're not talking money." "Information was the way I understood it."
"Information about what?" "You have a short memory. Reagan." "Oh, that." He waved his glistening nails in the quiet light from one of those bronze lamps that shoot a beam at the ceiling. "I hear you got the information already. I felt I owed you a fee. I'm used to paying for nice treatment. I didn't drive down here to make a touch. I get paid for what I do. Not much by your standards, but I make out. One customer at a time is a good rule. You didn't bump Reagan off, did you?"
"No. Did you think I did?"
"I wouldn't put it past you."
He laughed. "You're kidding." I laughed. "Sure, I'm kidding. I never saw Reagan, but I saw his photo. You haven't got the men for the work. And while we're on that subject, don't send me any more gun punks with orders. I might get hysterical and blow one down." He looked through his glass at the fire, set it down on the end of the desk, and wiped his lips with a sheer lawn handkerchief. "You talk a good game," he said, "but I dare say you can break 110. You're not really interested in Reagan, are you?"
"No, not professionally. I haven't been asked to be, but I know somebody who would like to know where he is." "She doesn't give a damn," he said. "I mean her father." He wiped his lips again and looked at the handkerchief almost as if he expected to find blood on it. He drew his thick gray eyebrows close together and fingered the side of his weather-beaten nose.
"Geiger was trying to blackmail the general," I said. "The general wouldn't say so, but I figure he was at least half scared Reagan might be behind it." Eddie Mars laughed. "Uh-huh. Geiger worked that one on everybody. It was strictly his own idea. He'd got notes from people that looked legal, were legal, I dare say, except that he wouldn't have dared sue on them. He'd present the notes with a nice flourish, leaving himself empty-handed. If he drew an ace, he had a prospect that scared, and he went to work. If he didn't draw an ace, he just dropped the whole thing.
Clever guy, I said. He dropped it, all right. Dropped it and fell on it. How come you know all this?
He shrugged impatiently. I wish to Christ I didn't know half the stuff he's brought to me. Knowing other people's business is the worst investment a man can make in my circle. Then if it was just Geiger you were after, you're washed up on that angle. Washed up and paid off. I'm sorry about that. I wish old Sternwood would hire himself a soldier like you on a straight salary to keep those girls of his home at least a few nights a week. Why? His mouth looked sulky. They're plain trouble. Take the dark one. She's a pain in the neck around here. If she loses, she plunges, and I end up with a fistful of paper, which nobody will discount at any price. She has no money of her own except an allowance, and what's in the old man's will is a secret. If she wins, she takes my money home with her. You get it back the next night, I said. I get some of it back. But over a period of time, I'm loser. He looked earnestly at me as if that was important to me. I wondered why he thought it necessary to tell me at all. I yawned and finished my drink. I'm going out and look the joint over. I said, yes, do. He pointed at a door near the vault door. That leads to a door behind the tables. I'd rather go in the way the suckers enter. Okay, as you please. We're friends, aren't we, soldier? Sure. I stood up and we shook hands. Maybe I can do you a real favor someday, he said. You got it all from Gregory this time. So you own a piece of him, too? Oh, not that bad. We're just friends. I stared at him for a moment, then went over to the door I had come in at. I looked back at him when I had it open. You don't have anybody tailing me around in a gray Plymouth sedan, do you? His eyes widened sharply. He looked jarred. Hell no, why should I? I couldn't imagine, I said, and went on out. I thought his surprise looked genuine enough to be believed. I thought he even looked a little worried. I couldn't think of any reason for that.